wish a happy birthday to Murray Nichols, Jackie Parker, Libby Watson, Avery Smith, and a happy anniversary to Eric and Adrian Raymond. Our sanctuary flowers are given to the honor and glory of God and in honor of Jackie Parker's birthday by Kim, Katie, Anna Lauren, and Chandler. You'll find attendance books at the end of each row. Please take a minute and sign in so we can keep an accurate records on our attendance. We have forms. If you want to order a poinsettia, the ushers have those forms. If you don't have one and want one, please let an usher know and we'll bring you one. Our accolades this morning are Maggie Nichols and Tripp Nichols, our nursery worker is Terry Main. Our children's Christmas practice will be this afternoon at 4:30 here in the sanctuary. Then they will join in with Hicks and Youth for a snack meal at 5:30 and Christmas movie night from 6 to 7:30. Kids can wear their appropriate PJs, bring a blanket and pillow to cozy down for a good meal. Tomorrow morning, our UWF and UMW will have their Christmas meeting at 10 o'clock in the fellowship hall. Everyone bring their favorite snack foods to share, and all women are invited to attend. This Wednesday, we will have food pantry, then choir practice at 5:30, cantata practice at 6. Both of those practices are in the sanctuary, and our youth will meet at 6 o'clock. This Saturday, our white Christmas boxes will be assembled at 3 o'clock in the fellowship hall. These boxes are taken to our shut-ins and those who reside in assisted living and nursing homes. There's an insert in your bulletin for suggested items to bring or send to put in these boxes. Next Sunday afternoon, we'll be gathering here at Marvin at 4 o'clock for Christmas caroling and around 5:30 in the fellowship hall for the choir's annual soup supper. Everyone is invited and encouraged to attend for food, fun, and always fellowship. Our youth have an overflow coming up soon. If your young person is going to go, please let Desi or Tyler know by tonight. We need to have those numbers. Then I believe Linda has an announcement.
Can I make one really quick first? The team of stewards will meet next Sunday at 1 o'clock in the park. Thank you.
I'm just going to stand right here and holler. I'm Linda Thompson. I'm the secretary treasurer for our UMW United Women in Faith unit. And the main purpose of our group is one of them to promote, encourage, and participate in outreach and try to meet the needs of our church, our community, and the world. And each year we'd like to recognize members here who go above and beyond examples of service. In the New Testament, there was like a power couple, I call them a missionary power couple, Priscilla and Aquila. And they are mentioned 6 times throughout the New Testament. In Romans chapter 16, verse 3, the Apostle Paul called them his fellow co-workers in Christ. They were steadfast and humble, serving with strength and purpose. In our midst, we have such a power couple, a quiet, humble power couple, and we'd like to recognize them with a special recognition pin to honor them for their servanthood. They not only serve here to meet the needs of children and hungry, but also those affected by disasters of our wider community and our world. So I'd like to ask Rita and Russell Parker to come forward.
Linda, I'm sorry.
country, and they've started a service team to provide yard work and home repairs and other things for people who just can't do those things on their own. They're involved in KICS and the Methodist Children's Home, volunteering to serve and work where needed. And they regularly perform things that we don't even probably know about. Love the hands and the feet of Christ.
Thank you. There are sign-up sheets in the fellowship hall for opportunities to serve. Please take a moment to look through those and see where God's calling you that you might be able to participate. There are a number of other announcements during this month. Just go through your bulletin so you don't miss anything upcoming. Are there any other announcements? Now let us quiet our hearts as we prepare for worship, and may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. this world can be so dark and so troubling, yet you are light and you are love. May your light from the darkest corner of this world and all the corners of our hearts starting today. For one day the light will overcome the darkness, love will conquer evil, and Jesus will save all. We pray in his name. Amen. Open the hymn is on page 368, celebrating the hope we have in Jesus. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood.
Of the liturgical year. We begin the season of Advent. Because I'm going to talk further about time and about space. You know, we get together and it's kind of all one time. Time that Christ has for all of us. And the real reason why the church gathers is to remember what Christ has done for us. That's why this worship is so special. And so we prepare our hearts as we come to the table, and as we partake of the elements, and as we rededicate ourselves to God and to God's service. So I invite you to join me on page 12 in your hymnal and read in the dark print. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one
another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Beloved, hear the good news of the gospel. The good news that every church should be shouting from the rooftops. The good news that our lives should personify as we leave this place and go out into the world. That Christ died for us, even while we were sinners and didn't deserve it. But that proves God's love for us, all of us. So in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. We invite our ushers to come forward that we may worship God with God's tithes and our offerings. Lord, in this moment of worship, we pause to give thanks and to give back. Bless our efforts, Lord. Bless the gifts and the givers to further your kingdom here on earth and us in your service. In Christ's holy name. Faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. Please do be seated. One of the liturgical traditions of the church is the lighting of the Advent candle. So we're blessed to have Reuben, Haley, Avery, and Lovey as they light the first candle of Advent. We have kind of a new electronic lighter here. Come on.
Instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus.
And these words from the letter of St. Paul to a community of Christians living long ago, we hear an important message for us right at the beginning of Advent. First, we hear that God is the one who is at work in us, something to remember not only during Advent, but throughout the year. God is the source of love and of the strength we need to love one another every day. Jesus came to us as a baby long ago in Bethlehem so that we might be saved and grow in holiness each day. The second thing Paul reminds us of is that God's gift to us means that we have something to do too. In fact, we are doing it right now as we pray, learning how we ought to live and gaining the strength from God to live in that way.
Good reading, Avery. Good job. Now we invite the young and the young at heart, if you'd like to come down front for the children's message.
Hey, guys. How are y'all today? Good? You're good? Great. So how many of you guys have your Christmas trees up already? You guys have yours up? Wow, you don't have yours, that's okay. Mine's not up yet either. But y'all are doing good, y'all are ahead of the game. And you've already got your stockings up, yeah? Wow. And Marie? And the little Christmas tree that y'all have. Wow. Well, what kind of ornaments do you guys like to put on your Christmas trees?
The unicorn one is the one I made at the college.
to you guys. I wanted to talk to you about a special Christmas tree. You guys know what that Christmas tree is called? That one over there? It's called a God Christmas tree. It's a lot like that. It's called a Chrismon tree. Because there was a lady in 1957, and her name was Frances Spencer. And she looked at the ornaments on her Christmas tree and she said, huh, these are all pretty, but Christmas is supposed to be about Jesus, and these ornaments aren't about Jesus. So she decided to make one, and it's called a Chrismon tree, and that means Christ monogram. So all the ornaments on that tree have something to do with Jesus or God. And they're all made by hand, at least they're all supposed to be. I think there's a couple on there that maybe aren't supposed to be on there. But they're supposed to be made by hand, and they all mean something about Jesus. So will you guys come over to that tree with me? So let's see, how do we think some of these symbols remind us of Jesus? I see a lot of candles and a lot of lamps. How do you think the candles and the lamps would remind us of Jesus? He's the holy light. He's the holy light, yeah. Yeah, we say that he's the light of the world. And the crown, because he's the king, yeah. And there's the cross. The cross, because he died on the cross. Y'all are so smart. What about the earth? What do you think that could remind us of? That God made the earth and that Jesus came to save the whole earth? Yeah. And there's some funny symbols on here, too. And the star, yeah. Yeah, yeah, the manger that they put Jesus in when he was born. Man, y'all are so smart. Yeah, there's a tiny present under there. There's a star up there because of the star when Jesus was born. Yeah. And they followed it. Yeah, all the way on top to remind us that Jesus is king. Yeah, a little bit. And there's a shell. That has to do with baptism. That reminds us of the water that Jesus was baptized in. So there's all these different ways that we can remember Jesus. Isn't it cool that he did so much that we have so many different ways? That's a bird, that's a dove, yeah. And there's a tiny gift, yeah, there's lots of things on the tree. Okay, so will y'all pray with me? All right. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for giving us so many ways to remember you and for helping us just to know that this season is about you and just for all the gifts that you give us. Amen.
When's that service going to be?
They had a private family visitation this past Friday, and I don't think there are any plans for a more formal service at this time.
Unspoken? Anybody else got unspoken? We all have someone carrying our hearts now, don't we? Who's taking care of somebody? Who's taking care of somebody? You taking care of somebody too? Mom? That's not what she said. We walk this walk together, we support one another, we reach out and try and take care of one another. And we have plenty of folks that aren't with us because they're taking care of somebody. And so as we do that, just keep them in your thoughts, and if you get a chance, reach out with a card or with a call or in whatever way to just let the spirit of the church reach out and touch their hearts. Because as we pray today, we unite our hearts and we unite our voices with people all around the world, everyone in Christ's presence. So as we pray, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up praise and give you thanks because whatever it is that we're worried about, we know that you've got it. And Lord, whatever happens, we know that you've got us. So Lord, we just hand over all the stresses of this world, all the things that in our lives that we have to do, that we may lift up the joy, that we may lift up the peace, that we may lift up the hope and the love of this child that is born for us this season. Lord, we give you thanks as we pray together. Amen. And now, our special music by our Marvin Springs, and we pray for them too.
Thank you.
from Luke 21. This is the same day that Jesus is arrested and persecuted. And so this is a passage where Jesus talks about signs of the ends of the age. Starting in verse 25, there will be signs in the sun, moon, and stars. On the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring and tossing of the sea. Men will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world, for the heavenly bodies will be shaken. And at that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and with glory. And when these things begin to take place, stand up, lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told him this parable. He said, look at the fig tree and all the trees. And when they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. I tell you the truth, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Be careful, on your hearts will be weighed. Be careful, or your hearts will be weighed down with dissipation, drunkenness, and the anxieties of life. And that day will close upon you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon those who live on the face of the whole earth. Be always on the watch and pray that you may be able to escape all that is about to happen, so that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man. Beloved, it's the word of God for the people of God. Let the people say,
thanks be to God.
Lord, as we prepare our hearts for the coming of this child once again, help us, Lord, so to hand over to you all the dissipation, the things that hold us back, and the anxieties of life. Christ's holy name. Amen. As I said earlier, Happy New Year. In the liturgical season, this is the first day of the Christian year. And we begin that telling the world, Emmanuel, God is with us. God is coming. Prepare yourself for the coming of the Lord. But as we say this, we know that practically speaking, Jesus came some 2,000 years ago. Why are we saying it again? Because in the spiritual world, in the biblical world, time is not linear. We tend to think that time is linear, but time is not linear. Time is more in a cycle. It's more cyclical. And so in our seasons, in our earth, in the way of nature, things happen in cycles. And so on this New Year's Day of the liturgical season, it's kind of ironic, or funny at least, to read a scripture about the end of the world and the end of the ages and the destruction of everything. Why would we do such a thing? Why would the people that write liturgy ask the churches to read a scripture about the end of the world on the first day of the year? Because it has a lot to do with the cycles of things. You know, history is littered with people that have tried to, in a timeline, predict the end of the world and trying to say, this is when Christ is coming back. Time and time again, people have tried to predict that, and they have failed miserably. And even as we look at this, Jesus says, this generation, he's talking 2,000 years ago, this generation will not pass away before these things that have happened. So in some sense, we might say, the second coming has already happened. Did we miss it? No. But there is this very real sense that we live kind of not in a linear time, but we live in a time of the Holy Spirit. We live in a time of creation of God that is really kind of a cycle of things. But even as we look around today, we can see wars and rumors of wars. We pray for Jerusalem, and we pray for that situation. We see what's going on in Ukraine. We hear about what's going on in Africa. We struggle with our denomination and in the politics. And oh, we just kind of get overwhelmed, and we get darkened with, what do we say here? Weighed down with dissipation. Drunkenness. Now I'm going to define drunkenness as all the things that we want to turn to just because life gets hard and the anxieties of life. Can anybody here identify with the anxieties of life? Can anybody feel that in the sense of time that we seem to be going through this time and time again, but Even as we look some 2,000 years ago, it was about the destruction of Jerusalem, the destruction of the temple. There's always been something going on. But that's not the message of the church. The message of the church is about life and light in Christ, because Christ has always been going on. We watch our acolytes, these young ones, they come up and they bring in the light of Christ. And the biggest lesson they learn is even in the anxieties of trying to get it all together and make it happen, stuff happens. The candles get blown out. But the real message of the gospel is we share the light. We share the light. We cover for one another. We help and support one another. And every time we do that, it's like we're on watch for Christ. Keep watch. Keep watch and see the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ as it shows up in our lives. Because every time that we do something to bring hope and joy and love to somebody, we bring Christ right back. This is why the church gathers, to remember this meal. This is what Christ did for us, always to remember, but especially this season of Advent. It's not about linear time. It's about the time of Christ always coming for us, that we can light that candle in the darkness. I invite you to join me on page 13 in your hymnal as we continue the liturgy. And I'm sorry, isn't this why I asked Reverend Roger Flowers to come up and join us? So good to have Brother Roger in our midst.
Let us pray together, Lord, in prayer. our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Invite the servants, if you would come first, so that they may serve you. We invite all to come to the table this morning as we remember the light of Christ that we carry in our hearts and how we share that with others. As we come, I want you to know that this is an open table. It's open to Christians of all faiths and faiths of all Christians. Any monies that might be left at the altar are going to Methodist Children's Home as we are starting another project with them. We're going to invite our choir to come first. And as you come, we invite you to come under the direction of the ushers and come all the way to the ends and the mats.
Can I say something about the green rail real quick?
Oh, for the Methodist Children's Home, as you represent, please do.
All the money, the cash, will be given to them for a defibrillator that they're in need of. But we're going to have a box out in the fellowship hall later for personal items for the kids. That if you want to get something tangible, you can put in that box.
Thank you. go.
Thank you.
As we sing our closing hymn, I remind you, this is just the beginning. We go out into the world to share this because there is plenty of anxiety. There is plenty of struggle in this world, but we celebrate the Christ who has come for us. Page 211 in your hymnal, I'll invite you to stand as we sing. Give you peace, with all God's children say.